Michel and Juan has already been on the floor, and there he told us about the case of technology assessment. I think what you will do now is make us remember some part of the history and then maybe say a little about what we can use that for in the future. That's my feeling. The floor is yours, Michel.
Yes, so first of all, I would like to take you back to the years 82-83. At that time, we had no personal computer, we had no internet, but at the same time, we had a strong need for technology assessment and parliamentary technology assessment in our country, as it can be the case today for a few of you that wonder whether to create a parliamentary technology assessment structure. Why did we create a technology assessment structure within Parliament in France at that time? Well, it had been a long process that had started, in fact, with the economic crisis of 73-74, you know, the rise of oil prices and the difficulties of economic growth that was stopping. And there was really a big debate in society about what to do. And it was not so easy to invent a new model of development at that period. Of course, the first ideas of creating a structure of technology assessment within Parliament came from the opposition parties that wanted to have a better control of the government. And there were many draft law proposals to create such a body within Parliament in order to better control the government. And after, of course, at first the government opposed this idea. But after a few years, in 81, there was a big change because the Socialist Party came to power. And those that had been the advocates of technology assessment as they were in the opposition were now in power. And they thought it would be a good idea to augment, to increase the power of control of Parliament. Because think of what the Parliament is doing. Of course, it has a legislative task, but it has also a tremendous task of control of government. And this was supported by, at that time, by all political parties. And there was a model, the model of the United States, the model of the Office of Technology Assessment. But of course, as it was the United States, it was huge. Many, many persons working, and we didn't have the means of the United States. As today, you may ask yourself, well, France, it's too big, we don't have these means. It's exactly the same situation, if you think. So we decided to do what we could do within our own system, within our own traditions. What were our traditions? Well, first of all, in our parliament, we have a habit of having parliamentarians that take reports, that are nominated rapporteurs, and that write reports. 30 pages, 50 pages, 100 pages, 200 pages. It depends on the time they have. And it depends also on the type of help they can receive from parliamentary civil servants. And I'm one of them. So it was our tradition. Maybe it's not the case in your country. Maybe there are other solutions. Maybe you can use postdoc students having a fellowship. I don't know. But this was our tradition. Of course, the question is, why did Parliament need to have its own structure? We had consultants, we had lobbies, we had governmental agencies, we had the Academy of Science, we had all these big scientific institutions like the National Center for Scientific Research, CNRS, and there was expertise everywhere. But the question is, when there are so many experts, what experts do you listen to? And what do you make with all these reports that you receive on your table? And Parliament felt that it had to have its own expertise within its own body to be able to have to make its own opinion. At least to have people that would read the reports coming from outside. You know, one more report that will be dropped in a basket. And as it was a tradition in France to organize these hearings, so OPEX was created with this tradition of organizing hearings and of making reports, and of course reports who are made by parliamentarians assisted by staff. The question of the independence of expertise of Parliament was absolutely crucial. And the question of the role of parliamentarians was also absolutely crucial. Why did we want so much to be independent? Because at that time there was a tremendous political problem. We had a state within the state. Électricité de France, EDF, the French electrical company, was so powerful that it dictated its wishes to many ministers. Not all of them, but it was too powerful. And Electricité de France had to be controlled from outside and from outside the government. So, in fact, we had this power play. And from the very beginning, it appeared that it was absolutely necessary within Parliament to have a structure that would control nuclear energy. And over three decades, OPEX has become the structure that controls the government structure or the independent structure that controls nuclear energy. So two steps. Then, why did it work and why do we need this parliamentary technology assessment structure today in France? It worked because from the very beginning there was a strong wish to have a bipartisan approach and to have a stability in the way we work on these problems. It was eased because from the very beginning it was decided to work on issues where decisions had not been taken. It's always easier to work on issues that will require decisions for the next 5 years or 10 years or 15 years than for issues that require decisions for tomorrow. It's almost impossible because, of course, government has taken decisions and as parliamentarians of a majority have to support government, it's very difficult to criticize. So it's much easier to be efficient and innovative when decisions have not been taken yet. Then it appears very clearly that we really need a forum to gather all actors interested by a difficult question. I'm talking about nanotechnology, I'm talking about nuclear energy, I'm talking about genetically modified organisms, I'm talking about shale gas, I'm talking about medically assisted procreation. I'm talking about bioethics. All these subjects that are highly controversial in our society, where there is a fight between parties, between religious groups, between ONGs, NGOs. And we need a place to organize a civilized debate on controversial issues. In our system, it's Parliament. In our system, it's OPEX. In your system, it can be different. But you know, just think of that, it adds something more, it's added political value. The main question is, how do you make parliamentarians and civil society understand what scientists write? I don't know how it is the case in your country, but in my country we do not understand the speech of scientists. Of course, if you are trained, and I'm one of those that are trained, we can always translate what scientists have written into normal terms. And I say, I'm a cultural mediator, I'm a cultural interpreter, and I explain to politicians what scientists have written. But very few scientists know how to do that. Some might, but in France it's difficult to find. Our question today is really to reconcile public policies and values. Values, it's a word that has been used many times today. We, of course, we have to think of ethics. Of course, we have to think of best practices. Of course, we have to think of difficult policy choices. It is not evident to know whether it's good or bad to promote research on genetically modified organisms or shale gas. There are many answers. There are two ways. Either you forbid with exceptions, or you authorize, but you take precautions. the attitude of OPEC is much more to authorize but to take precautions. It's not always what is decided by government that tends at the moment to say no, we forbid but with exceptions. So we have ongoing debates with government about it. I'll finish by saying that there is really a need to reconcile short-term and long-term policies. And there's where technology assessment is very important and is a very, very interesting tool. Of course, Parliament is the place, it's one of the places, but it's a very important place where policies for the long term are defined. And as I told you, it's easier to think in the long term. There is a problem of agenda. How much time do you have to work on a report? You never know what, you cannot judge of the quality of any document if you don't know in which conditions it has been written and how long, how much time people that had to write it had in front of them. In OPEC, we made this decision very, very early that we would take 1 year to work on a subject. That's why now I can stop in 1 second.
Thank you, Michel.